Hi, everyone, and welcome to Moments of Hope Church Online. Happy Mother's Day to all the mothers out there. As we begin our service this morning, I'd like to share with you some events that are happening in the ministry of Moments of Hope Church, beginning with Hope Men. They're going to be meeting the next two Tuesdays at Carmel Presbyterian from 6:30 to 8 p.m. Next, our night of prayer is going to be at Providence Square on May 15th at 6:30. We'd love for you to join us this evening. We also have a wholeness retreat and a worship night coming up at Hope Farm on Saturday, May 20th. If you'd like to attend either one of these, we'd love for you to go ahead and register online so we can plan for you to join us. And we have Hope Farm Day Camps for our Hope Kids. This is our ministry for our first through fifth graders. These day camps will take place on June 13th and June 15th. For details on all of these Hope Farm events, please check out our website and go ahead and register so you don't miss out. Now, let us turn our hearts to worship. We are having the privilege of being able to worship our risen Lord and Savior. And as we've been in a study of From Victory lately, remember that as you go into worship now, we are worshiping from victory. Let's join together and worship now.
There's peace that outlasts darkness, hope that's in the bud. There's future grace that's mine today, that Jesus Christ has won. So I can face tomorrow, for tomorrow's in your hands. All I need, you will provide, just like you always have. I'm fighting a battle you've already won. No matter what comes my way, I will overcome. Don't know you're doing, I know what you've done. I'm fighting the battle you've already won. Oh. There's mercy in the waiting, manna for today. When it's gone, I know you're not, you are my hope and stay. And when the sea is raging, your spirit is my help. Fix my eyes on Jesus Christ, and I'll say it is well. Oh, I know that it is well. I'm fighting a battle you've already won. No matter what comes,
story ends. We will be with you again.
You're my Savior, my defense. No more fear in life or death. I know how the story ends. We will be with you again. You're my Savior, my defense. No more fear in life or death. Still fall at the mighty sound of praise. They'll say, my God is still the same. When did he break his promise? When did his kindness fail? Never has, never will. My God is still the same. When did he lose his power? When did his mercy change? Never has, never will. My God is still the same. Just ask the words you prayed in desperation if the hurt. They'll say, my God is still the same. Ask the grave if it's strong enough to keep open its chains. It'll say, God is still the same. Yeah. When did he break his promise? When did his kindness fail? Never has, never will. My God is still the same. When did he lose his power? When did his mercy change? Never has, never will. My God is still the same. Never has, never will. My God is still the same. Not once did he ever stop moving. Not once has he ever let go. Not once did he ever stop proving our God is in control. Not once did he ever stop moving. Not once has he ever let go. Once did he ever stop proving our God is in control? When did he break his promise? When did his kindness fail? Never has, never will. My God is
ever stop moving. Not once has he ever let go. Not once did he ever stop proving our God is in control. Not once did he ever stop moving. Not once has he ever let go. Never has, never will. My God is still the same. Never has, never will. My God is still the same.
Hi, everyone. In case you don't know, my name is David Chadwick, and I'm one of the pastors here at Moments of Hope Church. And I regularly love to bring you the word of the Lord. And I hope in this environment, the way we're doing online worship with you, and especially the preaching moment, is more intimate, more personal from my heart to your heart, because it's just me and you right now speaking these truths that God has laid on me. It's basically the same message I do on Sunday morning at 9 and 11, though there is a beautiful congregation gathered in the round here. It's very special, and I hope you've come and been a part of that on a regular basis. But if this is how you are involved with Moments of Hope Church, let me speak from my heart to yours today as we continue this whole message of this is how we fight our battles from victory and to stand firmly, courageously, immovably in our faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, defeating this enemy, this evil one, the devil who wants to kill, steal, and destroy our lives. Now, before I jump into the message, just real quickly, as we see nationally the whole Title 42 situation unfold and immigrants coming into our nation, there are a good number who are here legally. They have filed for asylum, but they have to wait for 2 to 3 years to meet before a judge. And during that time period, they're basically given a cell phone and the opportunity to be transported to somewhere in the United States until that chance to appear before a judge occurs. One of the major places that they're coming is to Charlotte for two reasons. One is there is a judicial way of them having an appearance for asylum ASAP here, even though, again, that might be a year or two. They're also coming to Charlotte because the word on the streets is we're a loving, caring Christian community and they'll be cared for. They're more specifically coming to Charlotte because on the north side of town, there's a church called Camino Church with whom we have a partnership here at Moments of Hope Church. We are trying to help them as they care for in their whole ministry, not just before the Title 42 challenge, but in their whole ministry, ministering to the ever-burgeoning Latino population. So with the numbers that have come here, some of them even have Rusty Price's personal cell phone number because it's been passed on from people who say, hey, here's where you can get help, here's where you can get help. They are being deluged with dozens upon dozens upon dozens of these asylum seekers. And Moments of Hope Church is trying to step in the gap to help Camino Church care for these people, created in the image of God, without any place to go, without any food, without any clothing, without water, without supplies, simply to survive. And we're trying to help. And so we have talked to Rusty Price at Camino. We have gotten some ways for you to give gifts, food, clothing, all of those kind of things to help these immigrants right now. And please look at this link below, and it's a way that you can help out. You can give, and you can care, you can share. And Deuteronomy 10:19 says that we are to care for the foreigner and the sojourner in our midst. You know, we're not to ask, you know, things about their past, who they are, all those things. If they're legal, and they are, we are to care for them in the name of Jesus. So we're trying to, and again, here's the link that you can go to in order to reach out and care, because folks, biblically, we are to care for the immigrant. That's what God said. And, you know, again, I ask the question a lot, you know, why isn't that immigrant me? You know, why was I born in a nation where I have some stability, some family ties, all of that? And I'm not having to flee all kinds of disaster, wars, problems to get some kind of safety for me and my children. And if I was in that position, I'd want people, especially who call themselves followers of Jesus, to care for me as well. So as we do it unto the least of these, my brothers and sisters, Matthew 25, Jesus said we're doing it to himself, doing it to Jesus himself. So thank you for letting me bring that to your attention. Now let's move to this whole idea of, again, this is how we fight our battles, by standing courageously, firmly, against the devil. And we're looking at Ephesians chapter 6, verses 10 through 14, as we put on the full armor of God. And as we put on the full armor of God, we have that which we need to defeat the wiles and schemes of the devil. So let me read again these verses that we looked at last week that we'll be looking at for the next couple of months as we put on each piece of the armor, which help us know how to stand against the wiles of the devil. Look at this. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of His might. How do we fight our battles? We let the Lord fight them for us. We go into Him and we let His strength and His might fight for us. But we're also, as we let Him fight for us, do our responsibility. We put on the whole armor of God. We choose to put these pieces of the whole armor of God. And I'm going to emphasize week after week that you're going to have to put on each one of these pieces regularly, I would say even daily, to fight this fight against an enemy who wants to kill, steal, and destroy your life. That's John 10:10a. That's what Jesus said was the job description of the devil, to kill, steal, and destroy. And we put on the full armor of God that you may be able to stand. There it is. Be immovable. Be strong. Be courageous. Not be a wimp in this culture. Not give in to the apparent powers and principalities surrounding us, wanting to destroy us, our families, this church, and our great nation. And we stand against the schemes, the wiles, the methods of the devil. The devil means the divider. He wants to divide us and our families, our nation. He is an enemy of our soul. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers over this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. So our fight is not against flesh and blood, people, as evil as they may be. And even though they may need to be placed in prisons or removed from society in isolation, all of those kind of things because of their lawless actions, our real enemy is not flesh and blood. It is the powers and principalities in an ordered form with the devil, Satan at the top, and hierarchies of generals and colonels and majors and captains and sergeants in his demonic hierarchy, whom he tells what to do to go attack. And he looks at us and he devises schemes, strategies, and methods, knowing our weaknesses, having observed us carefully. And though he can't force us to do anything, he puts temptations in front of us, knowing our weaknesses, so that like a lure bumping up against the nose of a fish, will bite that temptation, and he goes, reels us in, and he has us entrapped in his schemes. And that's how he operates. And so our warfare is not against people, it's against the devil and all of his principalities and powers in the demonic region that are warring against us, tempting us regularly to get us on the devil's side, or certainly give us a spiritual ACL so we're on the sidelines in the battle of faith so that we have no influence upon our lives, others' lives, and this culture in which we live. Therefore, whenever you see a therefore in the Bible, you need to know what it's there for. Therefore, since this is our battle against the devil, take up the whole armor of God. There it is again. It's your choice. You've got to put it on. Nobody will do it for you, not even the Lord. Take up and also the whole armor of God, every piece of it that you may be able to. Now look at these words, withstand in the evil day. What evil day? Every day. Every day is an evil day because the evil one is trying to attack and destroy you. You'll be able, though, to withstand him as he attacks you. And having done all to stand firm, verse 14, stand therefore, four times in these verses, stand, stand therefore, withstand, stand. Having fastened on, and this was last week's message, the belt of truth. It's the first piece of the full armor, and it means that you believe that there is truth in this world. There is absolute reality, fixed, objective truth that we believe, just biblically looking at some of the things going on in the world today, that there are two fixed genders, male and female, that there is a fixed order that God designed in marriage, Genesis 2:24, repeated by Jesus, God himself, in Matthew 19, between a man and a woman. We believe there is a fixed, objective order in our gender. It's not fluid, and there aren't 30 or 300 different genders in the world, and that we are not what we feel. We are in the fixed order of God's universe, who He says we are. And unless you believe in the fixed objective order of the universe and believing that God, our Creator, has designed those fixed orders, and our job is to believe that and live by what God has designed, unless you start with the truth, you can't go to the next piece of the armor of God, because as Paul looked at Roman soldiers in the prison cells, when he's writing a lot of these letters, he saw that the belt was fastened to the breastplate. And the breastplate has no power unless it's fastened to the belt. So after you believe in fixed, objective, realistic truth in this world, and we don't believe in a postmodern culture where truth is whatever you want to define it as, truth is what I feel, we believe truth is what God says it is. After that, then, you believe the next fixed part of the armor of God is the breastplate of righteousness. The breastplate of righteousness. Now, what is righteousness? Righteous means redeemed. I am forgiven. I am made right in the sight of God. Now, this, again, comes against the culture's whole idea of I live by my feelings. And what is right or what is wrong, what is described as righteous, is whatever I feel that it may be. And the problem, of course, with that is all kinds of people feel all kinds of different things. They oftentimes collide with one another. And when they do, the side that has more power tries to suppress those that don't believe what they believe. And you then have charges of hate speech going on, and which for people who are pastors like myself, we've got to preach the bad news of people's sin and rebellion against God. And whenever you call something hate speech, you've hated speech. Because we used to live in a modern culture where there was a confluence of ideas coming together at the table, and people could debate those ideas, and over time, we would see what's really true, and the truth would be known. But in the postmodern culture, which began to have a lot of power about 30 years ago, truth is eroded, and truth is defined by whatever I feel. Rightness is defined by whatever I feel. And then if you are then making me feel badly in any possible way, I'm going to suppress your truth, and you are wrong in whatever you may say. Moreover, if you say, well, this is a fixed order in our universe, this is what God sees as truth, a person will come back and say, you've really hurt my feelings. And somebody's hurt feelings trumps everything. If you say that really hurts my feelings, you've shut down the argument. In the postmodern idea, you are a hurt person. You have your safe space. And therefore, we have all around us in our workplaces, in our university settings, so many places where people can supposedly go and be safe in order not to have any kind of hate speech spoken against them. But what you've really done is you've suppressed free speech altogether. You've suppressed the sharing of ideas. You've suppressed any understanding of there being an objective truth. And therefore, righteousness, what's right or what's wrong, that whole idea can never be brought to the table. But for Christians, we stand up and we put on the breastplate of righteousness, which protects our most vulnerable organs. Because the enemy knows if he can make us feel foolish and stupid and put down and silenced and unimportant in our culture, he's got us. But we can't, folks. We've got to stand up and say, I have put on the breastplate of righteousness over my most vulnerable organs, especially my heart. And the heart of the matter is a matter of the heart, that there is righteousness. God has a right way of living, a right way for this world to operate, and knowing that I have failed him and I'm unrighteous in a lot of ways. I've not lived as he wants me to live. I've not been the kind of person he wants me to be. I confess my sins and realize he is faithful and just and forgives me of all unrighteousness, 1 John 1:9. That I'm forgiving of all of my unrighteousness. And here's what's the kicker, folks. When we confess our sins and our unrighteousness is forgiven by God, we then have the very righteousness of Jesus covering our hearts. In other words, that when God looks at us, he does not see our muck, he does not see our junk, he does not see our rebellion, he does not see all the ways we have hurt his heart. No, indeed, 2 Corinthians 5:21 says that he who knew no sin, that's Jesus, conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit, Jesus, the perfect God-man, Jesus perfectly obeyed the righteous requirements of the law and went to the cross and died in our place in a substitutionary atonement on that cross. It should have been our crown of thorns, our spear, our nails, our cross. We should have died on that cross because of our rebellion against God, but because he loves us so much by grace through faith, he gives us the forgiveness of our sins, and he who knew no sin became sin. Jesus took on all the sins of the world, your sin, your rebellion, my rebellion, your stiff-arming God, my stiff-arming God, all the ways that I've hurt his heart, all the ways you've hurt his heart, all of those sins, all of those rebellion against God's will that we knew better, we should not have done, he took upon himself. He became sin for us. At that moment, from 12 till 3 o'clock in the afternoon, the Bible tells us everything went dark. There was a spiritual battle in the heavenlies with Jesus and Satan going toe-to-toe with one another. And Jesus' death on that cross took all of our sins upon himself. There was darkness everywhere. I think Satan danced the jig with all of his demonic hordes, joining in the chorus line, going, "We won, we won, we won." But they just didn't know what was going to happen on the third day. Because on the third day, Jesus was raised from the dead, thus proving that God had accepted his sacrifice for our sins, and then he offers us the forgiveness, the redemption, the righteousness of our sins being forever forgiven by grace through faith. And when we go through what's called the great exchange, Jesus takes our sin upon himself and gives us his righteousness back. I mean, it's received as a free gift. Who wouldn't accept that gift? Who's crazy enough not to freely accept that gift? Because he who knew no sin, back to 2 Corinthians 5:21, became sin so that we might become, folks, the righteousness of God in Christ. That means that when you receive Jesus, you can put over your heart God's righteousness so that when he looks at you, not only do you know there is right truth, right living, a standard of how to live, not only that, you know that you have been forever forgiven by God in Jesus in Christ. Now, those of you who are watching right now, say in your heart, forever forgiven. Forever forgiven. That you are a new person in Christ. How do you defeat the wiles of the devil and the ways he attacks? Well, one of the clear ways is by putting over your heart a protection of those arrows that are slung toward us that suggest we are, because of our sin and rebellion, just awful people. You're just a terrible human being. How could God love somebody like you and David? How could God even put up with someone who has done the hideous things that you have done? I mean, you're an awful, godless, reprobate enemy of the Most High God. I mean, do you ever hear those voices? The voice of accusation, the voice of condemnation. We've talked about this before. And it's, again, aimed right at your heart. But then because of the death of Jesus, you have a bulletproof vest. Think about that as an image. think about what a bulletproof vest does. It allows a police officer or a soldier or anyone who's wearing it not to have to worry about dying, because the most vulnerable organs are totally protected. And your most vulnerable and important spiritual organ, your heart, Proverbs 4:23, that out of your heart is the wellspring of life. The heart of the matter is a matter of the heart. That Jesus gives you a new heart when he forgives you of your sins. And what you have then is his righteousness protecting you. And when you hear those voices about how awful you are, here's your answer. No, that person died. I remember burying that person deep in the grave. And it's covered with the love of Jesus. And I'm no longer that person, Galatians 2:20, I've been crucified with Christ. I went to that cross, and I have now become a new person. And the old has passed away, and the new has come. That's who I really am. I have a new righteousness, not based on the law. What does that mean when the Bible says we don't have a righteousness according to the law? That's what Paul's talking about, Philippians 3, for example. It's not based on my performance. It's not based on what I do. That's what a righteousness according to the law is. And folks, that's a lot of you people out there. You have an opinion of yourself, a righteousness of yourself based on your performance, based on what you do, based on your house, based on your car, based on your job, based on your degrees, based on your successes, based on your comparison to other people's performance. You know, I'm doing better than that guy. I'm doing better than that gal. I'm prettier than that person. I'm better looking than that person. I have more success than that person. And when you compare yourself to other people, and when you validate your sense of self-worth by what you do, that is a righteousness according to the law. And the problem with that is, what do you do the first time you fail? What do you do when that person that you've based your whole performance lifestyle on rejects you? What do you do when you get fired in the place you've worked for and in for years? Finally, they come to you and say, we don't need you anymore. What do you do when you maybe even do your best, like in an athletic performance, and you still lose the game? What do you do when the injury comes and you can no longer compete like you used to? If you have a righteousness according to the law, all it will do is fill you with guilt and shame. And guilt is what you do wrong, and the enemy keeps attacking you and says, look at all you've done wrong. And then shame is that you are wrong. As a human being, you are a bad, unrighteous human being. But don't you see what Jesus did on that cross? He heals our guilt and shame. He says, I take all of those mistakes that you've made, and I absorb them into my forgiveness. And that sense of shame that you have, I absorb that as well, because you're no longer that person anymore. And when the Father in heaven looks at you, he does not see your sin. He sees the righteousness of God in Christ. He sees Jesus' righteousness. Think about that. If that doesn't jazz you, nothing will. Because of Jesus' death on the cross and his resurrection from the dead, when God looks at you and me who've received that as a free gift of the great exchange, he takes my sin and gives me his righteousness. He sees the perfect righteousness of Jesus, not by anything we've done, but by grace through faith. Gosh, you know, if I could get you to right now, I'd ask you just to start yelling and screaming and applauding. That's what happens on Sunday morning a lot in this place in the round. People hear those kinds of words from me, and it just erupts into spontaneous, uproarious applause, because people go, I can't believe that good news. Isn't it good news? The bad news is we're awful people. We've rebelled against God. We're living in our unrighteousness. The good news is, by grace through faith in the cross of Calvary and the resurrection, we have a new righteousness, Jesus' righteousness, that has been bestowed upon us. Whew. And folks, you got to put on that breastplate. It's attached to truth. Because you can't have a righteous understanding of the law, you can't have a right knowledge of your sin and how you have hurt God's heart unless there is his righteousness before you. But your identity, who you are. Folks, if I could get you all to understand what I'm about to say to you, we would close down 90%+ of the counseling offices in America, because so many of our problems, mine included, are rooted in a false sense of identity. For example, in our culture, you have the LGBTQIA+ experience going on. And it's so interesting that just 10 years ago, only less than 2% of the population identified as such. Now, today, millennials, Gen Zers, 25% say that their gender is fluid and they identify with the LGBTQ+ identity. Now, what's really going on? I mean, first of all, there's a huge detransitioning idea going on in our culture. It's numbers of people who went through the transitioning whose bodies have been mutilated and they have been sterilized who deeply regret the decision that they made. Do I think that was the devil communicating lies to them? John 8:44, Jesus said, Satan is the father of lies. Of course. And does that fit with Satan's job description to kill, steal, and destroy? I mean, he has basically disallowed these people from ever giving life to someone else. It's just not going to happen. And now there's deep regret about that. Is that getting any headlines? Is anybody talking about that? Is the medical association talking about that? You just need to know Europe usually is 5 to 10 years ahead of us with some of these social experiments. You just need to know that in nations like Sweden and England and the Netherlands, as they have marched through this and seen people go through detransitioning, seen the mutilation of human bodies, the deep regret going on in their lives, they are stopping it. They're not allowing their teens to have this. And they're believing what the science says, and I'm one to believe in objective reality. The science says that plus 80% of these people, if they're feeling gender dysphoria, after they reach a certain year of adolescence, they will return to their natural birth gender. It's just a reality that is an objective fact. So you ask the question, why are they doing all these surgeries upon, you know, even kids as young as 5 or 6, and mostly in the age of 8, 9, 10, but even 12, 13, 14, folks, I go where angels fear to tread. Follow the money and you'll know why people do what they do. Follow the money and you'll know why people do what they do. The Bible says that the love of money is the root of all evil. Not money. Money's neutral. It's the love of money. And people wanting to depend upon money for fun, security, whatever. And that's what's causing a lot of this today. And you need to know that 40% of those people who go through that transitioning, they commit suicide or try to commit suicide. And of course, progressives say that's because they feel outcast in the culture, and if the culture would just accept them for who they are, that would go away. Folks, it's not going to go away, because the truth is, when you go against God's natural created order, the way he made the world, Genesis 1, verses 26 and 27, male and female, that God made marriage for a man and a woman only, when you go against God's created order, you will suffer the consequences. And it's been that way since day one. And that's what sin basically is going against God's natural laws, his created order, his will, our rebellion causing all of this sin and grief in the world. So that's an illustration of rebelling against God and trying to find our identity in something other than God. And I am convinced that a lot of the LGBTQIA+ is a social contagion. I believe it's a righteousness under the law. I believe it's people trying to find their identity with another group of people so that they can feel accepted. It's also the cool factor today, because I've made this decision and I'm working myself out because this is what's accepted. It is a righteousness under the law. It's against God's created order, and it will only end tragically. So the answer is to put on the breastplate of righteousness, to attach it to truth, but put on who we truly are in Jesus. Let me read these verses to you from 1 Peter chapter 2, starting with verse 9. And just notice who you are in Christ. These great statements about who you truly are in Christ. Talking about people who've rebelled against God. Then verse 9, but you. And who's that? You Christians. You who have received the righteousness of Jesus by grace through faith. You are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for his own possession, that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. You move out of that darkness, all the evil ones' schemes and lies, into Jesus' marvelous light, his truth that sets you free to enjoy life to the full. And here's who you really are. If you have the breastplate of righteousness over your heart, this is who you really are. First of all, you're chosen. You're chosen. I'll never forget the time when I was 10 years old. I went on a roller skating hockey trip with my brother Howard, and I was with all of his buddies who were 5 years older, and Howard got to be one of the team captains, and they started choosing people out there to be on their teams, and I went to the back because I was so much younger, and I didn't even know if anybody would want me to play, but Howard, my big brother, my wonderful big brother, who's with Jesus right now, man, I miss him. Gosh, I miss Howard so much. But anyway, at this point, he says, I choose first person I choose on my team is my little brother, David. Everybody who was there kind of separated like Moses in the Red Sea, and I from the back poked out my little bird chest, and I walked up front with a swagger, and I got behind my big bro. Why? Because I'd been chosen. Above all the others, I'd been chosen. Do you know that if you love Jesus, you've been chosen? Your big brother Jesus looked out over all the people on the face of this earth. He said, I want Peter. I want Eric. I want Joan. I want Jane. I want Jackie. I want Jack. I want you on my team. And you should just poke out your chest and walk with a swagger and say, man, I'm chosen. It should cause your identity, your personhood, to swell in joy. But not only that, you're a chosen race. Can I talk about this for a second? Do you see what the devil's trying to do? The devil's a divider. And he's trying to divide us into gender and, you know, those who have hurt feelings, those who don't. All of those different ways he's trying to divide. Another way he's trying to divide us is racially. Folks, there are not multiple races. They're not. There's one human race. And we all have a common color in our race. It's red, the blood of Jesus that's pulsating through our veins. And Jesus is supposed to break down all the restraining walls that keep us separate from one another. And we're one human race, and some are bigger, and some are smaller than others. Some have lighter skin, some have darker skin. Some have different kinds of curly hair, some have straight hair. The point being, everybody's different, but we're one human race. And the day we break down the barriers and the lies that we are multiple races is the day we can truly come together and be one. And that God loves all of us the same because we're all a part of the one human race. So we're chosen. We're a part of that one race, especially the race of people who love Jesus because we're in Christ. We're a royal priesthood. Two thoughts here. First of all, you're royalty. Jesus, the King of kings and Lord of lords, blood bought you into his kingdom. You now have royal blood pulsating through your veins. And you're a royal priesthood. That means you're a minister. Everybody in Moments of Hope Church is a minister. I have my call to try to unfold the word of God and to lead this church. You have your call. Where are you ministering for the Lord Jesus? If you're not, you don't understand your identity. Because your identity says to you, you are royal, but you're a priesthood. And priests are the ones who mediate between humans and God and humans. How are you bringing the grace of God to humans here on this earth? How are you caring for others? Is it with immigrants? With the poor? With the hungry? With the thirsty? With those who don't have clothes? The prisoner? The most marginalized, perhaps, in our whole culture? How are you being a minister to serve other people. And you're also a holy nation, that we who are Christians have come together as kind of a unique nation ourselves. Let me address this real quickly. David, do you believe in Christian nationalism? Well, if you think I believe that the United States should be a Christian nation, I'll say no, because our Constitution doesn't allow it. We do not allow one faith to become the nation's faith. Do I believe that the Christian laws of the Bible, which God gave to us to follow, and when they're followed, they will grant human flourishing, should be the laws of our land? Things like sex really should only be within a man and a woman in marriage. I know that's going to go nowhere in the nation, but that marriage and family is still the most important unit for human flourishing to occur in America, and laws should protect marriage and family the best way possible. Do I believe that we should have ways for people to succeed in their dreams and not be so heavily taxed that they can't do that? Those kind of laws which grant human flourishing, yes, I believe that, because I believe they're laws from God, and when we follow laws from God, we're following His will, and He will bless that accordingly. So, but we are a holy nation. We're not a Christian nation per se, but we're a holy nation. What does that mean? It means the church is different. The church is different. And how are we different? This is what's supposed to happen. It's not happened largely in some other churches, because a lot of churches more and more are putting themselves over the Bible and interpreting it the way they want it to be interpreted, so they'll never have anybody complain or leave, and they can always feel accepted. But holy people of Jesus are under the Bible, and we believe, thus saith the Lord, is spoken to us in how we should live. And when we live the way Jesus wants us to live, it is radically different than the way the culture wants to live. It means we are humble people, we are authentic people, we are generous people, we are simple people, we don't need all the stuff of the world, and we are caring and giving people. We're different. We have sexual mores that are different than the culture's desire to let their feelings run wild and let anybody sleep with whomever they want to, whenever they want to. We are a different kind of people, and when we're so different and we experience God's human flourishing, the outside world is going to look at that, those in darkness, and say, I want to be a part of the marvelous light. Folks, that's who we really are. Another one is we're adopted, that God looked out over all the people and He adopted us into His family as rebels wandering from Him. He came to us while we were on the streets in hopelessness and adopted us into His family and made us heirs of everything He owns. Understand who you are in Christ. Understand your true identity. And then finally, behave righteously. For righteousness is not only who you are, it's how you live. When you know that you are righteous in Christ, you'll want to live righteously in all the ways I just mentioned, in being a holy people. There's an interesting story that happened evidently years ago with Alexander the Great, and he was conquering all the nations of the earth. One man ran away in battle, and he was brought before Alexander the Great, and Alexander scolded him for his cowardice, and he asked the man, "What's your name?" And the man purportedly responded, "Alexander." And Alexander was so offended that his own name was carried by this coward's name, and he said this, "Alexander, change your behavior or change your name." And I feel like Jesus wants to say to all of us today, as we fight against the devil and we are learning how to stand with truth and righteousness, if we're not living the way Jesus wants us to live, I think Jesus wants to say to people today, David included, either change your behavior or change your name. For those of us who love Jesus, dear friends, He's never needed us more to stand courageously for truth, for righteousness, and for this world to come out of its darkness into His marvelous light. To Jesus alone and always belongs all the glory. Dear friends, put on that belt of truth. Then attach it to the breastplate of righteousness, which protects your heart, knowing who you are in Christ and how you should live as a righteous person in Him, and you'll start to see victory over the enemy like never before. Father, I pray if there's anyone out there right now that does not love you, that is still living in their darkness and living in their sin, and if asked the question, if you appeared before Jesus right now and he asked you, why should I let you into my eternity? And you started responding with all your good works and all the things you thought you did well or your right attitudes or whatever. That's a righteousness according to the law. And dear friend, I'm warning you today, that will not get you to heaven. It will not get you to heaven. That's every other world's religion that says, here's what we got to do to earn God's acceptance. And Jesus accepts us only by what he did on the cross, not what we do for him. And his death on the cross is his way of saying, I know you can't. I know you're consumed with sin. You have the sin problem because of Adam's sin in Genesis 3. You were birthed with it. You came into the world with it. And I knew that. And I knew you were heading toward hell. But I so loved you. I came to you and died on the cross. And now give you the gift of forgiveness, redemption, and righteousness by grace through faith. Jesus is offering you right now out there watching the great exchange, where you can exchange your sin for his righteousness, not by what you do, but by his grace. And I just pray you'll open your heart right now and say, Lord Jesus, I receive that free gift. I give you my sin. Know it's buried deep into the heart of the sea, and I receive now your grace and forgiveness. And I just pray there's even one out there right now, even one who's watching this, who's giving their life to Jesus and realizes that in their own human effort, in buying a lot of the lies of the culture, they're far from God. Oh, but Jesus paid the price. Jesus paid it all. The cross is large enough to cross that chasm, and you can walk across that bridge into the presence of the Father and be loved and accepted by him. I pray that'll happen right now in many people's lives. But if even one comes to faith right now, all the hours I spent preparing this message is meaningful. So thank you, Lord, for the privilege of preaching. Thank you that I can proclaim your gospel message. And I pray that everybody right now who's watching can say to you one day when you ask the question, why should I let you into my eternity? They can say, only because of Jesus' death on the cross and the fact that I have the righteousness of Christ. And you're going to say, come on in and spend eternity with me. Thank you, Lord. It's in Jesus' name I pray this. Amen. Well, one of the scourges on our nation right now is human trafficking. It is an industry that earns more money than the National Football League, Major League Baseball, the National Basketball Association, all the major sports combined. All the revenues of those three major sports combined are still much less than what's earned through the pornography and trafficking industry. So to live righteously, we know we've got to be a part of addressing that problem. So today's Hope Gift is going to be a really wonderful gift to an agency here in this area that's trying to address human trafficking, because sadly, this Charlotte area is one of the largest human trafficking places in all of the world, largely because of the interstates that connect Charlotte, because we're the sixth busiest airport in the world, and because people who are immigrants can come here and they're so desperate they can be lured into the awful prostitution and sex trafficking industry. So, you know, as for Moments of Hope Church and our house, we're going to serve the Lord. We're going to stand up courageously and say we're going to do what we can do to fight and to bring people out of that darkness into Jesus' marvelous light. Jen Houston, would you now tell us about this special gift?
Thank you so much, David. I have the honor of sharing with you about this week's Hope Gift. Because of your generosity, we're able to give $40,000 this week to Project Freedom. Project Freedom was started by local Charlotte business leaders when they realized the need for emergent care for those coming out of human trafficking. They're in the middle of a fundraising campaign right now, and we are honored to be able to sow into this important ministry. They meet the physical, emotional, and spiritual needs of children and their mothers coming out of human trafficking. Thank you so much for sowing into our ministry so we can sow into other ministries that are helping children and mothers and so many other people bounce back to be able to have a successful life. And if you'd like to sow into our ministry today, you can click the Give button on the screen. You can give through our website or our app, or you can mail a check to 4500 Cameron Valley Parkway, Suite 400, Charlotte, North Carolina, 28211. If today's message has blessed you in any way, or if you have a testimony or a miracle to share, please feel free to chat with us below. We would love to hear how God is working in your life. And thank you so much for worshiping with us today, and we hope to see you next week.